And now, a very important lesson for us. Paul repeats only that which is scripture. Look at verse 21. For these reasons, in other words, because I'm a witness to the Gentiles primarily, the Jews seized me in the temple and tried to kill me. That's their beef. Not some made-up charges about bringing Gentiles in here and all that. It's just because I'm witnessing to the Gentiles and they don't like it. Therefore, having obtained help from God, to this day I stand, witnessing, continuing to witness, both the small and great, saying no other things than those which the prophets and Moses said would come, that the Messiah would suffer, that he would be the first to rise from the dead, and would proclaim a light to the Jewish people and to the Gentiles. Just what the scriptures said. That's all I'm doing. I'm just saying what the Jewish scriptures, the Old Testament, what they claim to believe, said would happen. Now the lesson there for us is the emphasis on the scripture. We should have the most passion, the most interest in the scripture over anything else. And there is a danger in the body of Christ. Now hear me carefully on this one. We recognize as Christians the grand conspiracy. We know the Bible. We know that although it's moving slowly like a glacier, ultimately the powers on earth are bringing things together in a way that the Bible says is going to happen before the return of Jesus Christ. We know that. And we have our eyes open. And Paul even says, you guys aren't in darkness, that this is a big surprise to you. You guys, your eyes are open. You see the headlines. You know what's going on. But we run the risk of lessening our witness by embracing a lot of stuff that comes under the conspiracy theory with a small c, if you will, that is not really supported by the scripture. And let me tell you what I'm talking about. I became a Christian. I came into the kingdom at the same time that Bill Clinton was coming into the presidency. And in those early formative months as a Christian, I heard a lot of preachers say a lot of stuff about, you know, Arkansas and the past and all these kind of things. And again, my eyes now open, seeing the world from a totally different perspective, from a biblical perspective, I was very eager to sort of receive all this stuff in. And to my shame, a lot of times that was what I was sharing with others when I should have been sharing Jesus Christ. I would share the stuff that I had heard. Did you know this about the president? No. Now, there is enough sin, legitimate sin, and evil in our country, in this world, to rail against, to get us in a world of trouble. And I'm not saying you don't rail against immorality. I do plenty of it from up here, as you know. But I'm saying we got to be careful. There's a line there that we can diminish what we're really all about. We're about sharing the gospel with unbelievers. And if part of that is to explain kind of where the world is going, because that does pique a lot of people's attention, fine. But we're living in times similar to the early 90s, where there's some kind of stuff that's out there that's not really provable. You can't really put your thumb on it, and you can't really point to scripture with it. And yet it becomes the focus when Jesus needs to be the focus. Because the Bible, even though many in our country mock it, the Bible still has a respect for many people in our country, still has an authority. It's still the book that those politicians put their hand on and swear their oath as they go into office. It's still the book found in every hotel room around the country. And so when Peter tells us, if anyone speaks, let him speak as the oracles of God. He's not saying all you should do is quote scripture all your life. But what he's saying is that as you speak, you should be speaking words that are supported by scripture, that are in line with the scripture. As you speak against the sins and the immorality of our age, you are speaking what, again, the Bible speaks against in so doing. And so that's that gray area we have to watch out for. Now, I'm grateful that after the first few years of that, I recognize that these guys are just, you know, if this was Leviticus, these guys would be dead because they're false prophets. They're predicting all this stuff that doesn't come to pass. So I stopped listening to them. So, for example, when I heard a pastor get the congregation all shook up that the chaos from Y2K is going to be so bad that President Clinton is going to use that opportunity and he is going to suspend the November elections and stay in office and make himself... A lot of Christians just soaked that up. And if I had just been saved, I probably would have soaked it up too. I probably would have shared that with somebody else instead of laughing at it and saying, oh, you know, laughing and crying and getting angry all at the same time. And then that would have been shared with my unbelieving family and friends instead of the love of Jesus Christ. And then, of course, when none of that came to pass, I would look like an idiot. And then how am I going to share Jesus with them next year and the year after and the year after? Because they're going to remember that.